From the library of the New York Stock Exchange at the corner of Wall and Broad Streets in New York City, you're inside the Ice House. Our podcast from Intercontinental Exchange on markets, leadership, and vision in global business. The dream drivers that have made the NYSE an indispensable institution of global growth for over 225 years. Each week, we feature stories of those who hatch plans, create jobs, and harness the engine of capitalism. Right here, right now at the NYSE and at ICE's exchanges and clearinghouses around the world. And now welcome Inside the ICE House. Here's your host, Josh King of Intercontinental Exchange.
Some of my fondest memories as a child? I'm in the back seat of my parents' Chevrolet Caprice Classic, covering the highways and byways of rural Vermont en route to Sugarbush Valley and Warren. As Interstate 89 gives way to Vermont Route 100, a little south of Burlington, history would begin to unfold for me, silently outside the rearview mirror as Mom and Dad chatted away in the front seat. Vermont, the 14th state admitted to the Union March 4th, 1791, counts as its hometown hero one Ethan Allen, a farmer, businessman, and patriot whose Green Mountain Boys captured Fort Ticonderoga on May 10, 1775, 1 month after the action at Lexington and Concord. Cannons from the fort, sitting at the mouth of the Lachute River between Lake Champlain and Lake George, a gateway to the Hudson River, would be hauled to Boston by Henry Knox, fortifying Dorchester Heights and helping to break the British siege, leading to the evacuation of the Redcoats. It's that kind of lore that created much of the revolutionary mystique around early New England, so much so that two 20th century salesmen, Nate Ansell and Ted Baumritter, bought a bankrupt sawmill in their beloved Vermont for $25,000 in 1935, and 4 years later, named a 28-piece line of colonial furniture in honor of Ethan Allen that they unveiled at the 1939 Chicago Housewares Show. Their millionth piece of furniture was presented to none other than President Dwight Eisenhower. And in 1969, the company's formal name was changed to that of their Vermont hero, just 7 years shy of America's bicentennial in 1976. Before long, that boy who watched the Vermont countryside roll by also started seeing Ethan Allen's showcase galleries pop up along the suburban landscapes where I grew up. Their columned facades, much like the New York Stock Exchange itself, standing for American solidity and values, a brand which allowed independent furniture dealers to have a recognizable storefront from which to sell their wares. "I bought it at Ethan Allen" became a sort of status symbol that Mom and Dad, guardians of the family unit, had finally arrived at their desired station in life, with beds, dressers, and tables made for their colonial homes. Alas. Nothing lasts forever, of course, except maybe an Ethan Allen dining room set. What happened in the ensuing decades is the stuff of another kind of American dream that starts in the mountains of Kashmir well before it gets to the Green Mountains of Vermont. In a minute, we'll welcome inside the Ice House Farooq Kathwari, the chairman, president, and CEO of Ethan Allen, who led a management buyout of the company in 1989 and in 1993 took the company public right here at the New York Stock Exchange, now trading under the ticker symbol ETD. Our conversation with Farooq Kathwari on entrepreneurism, marketing, manufacturing, and global affairs, and the journey from another side of the world to where we sit today on Wall Street. It's coming up right after this.
Connecting the opportunity is just part of the hustle.
Opportunity is using data to create a competitive advantage.
It's raising capital to help companies change the world.
It's making complicated financial concepts seem simple.
Opportunity is making the dream of home ownership a reality.
Writing new rules and redefining the game.
And driving the world forward to a greener energy future.
Opportunity is setting a goal.
And charting a course to get there.
Sometimes the only thing standing between you and opportunity is someone who can make the connection.
At ICE, we connect people to opportunity.
Our guest today, Farooq Kathwari, is the chairman, president, and CEO of Ethan Allen Interiors. That's NYSE ticker symbol ETD. He's been president of the company since 1985, a journey that started with his education in English literature and political science at Kashmir University and his MBA at NYU. With a roster of accolades and awards too numerous to recite here, I'll only add before we get into our conversation about all things commerce that Farooq is the dean of our New York Stock Exchange listed company advisory board and a beloved fixture here at the historic corner of Wall and Broad Streets. Happy New Year and welcome, sir, inside the Ice House.
It's always great to be here and to be part of this great, great exchange. I started my career right next door, One Wall Street, and it's a, you know, it's after enough, or 50 years later, I continue to come here.
Amazing what has happened in that 50 years to One Wall Street, just opened up now, as rehabbed as condominiums. Farooq, it's great to have you here. Wall and Broad is about 70 miles from Danbury, Connecticut, the longtime home of Ethan Allen, but given the bit of history that I just relayed, what kinds of emotions are spurred when you walk through these doors just across the harbor from Ellis Island, where you were the 2018 recipient of the Ellis Island Medal of Honor?
Well, you know, when I reflect on my journey, this is a journey about, this is a story about America. I was just 20 years old when I left these beautiful mountains of Kashmir and ended up in beautiful Brooklyn. And I needed a job. And I saw an ad. It said bookkeeper. I'd never seen any books or even a calculator in my life. But anyway, I convinced the small owners of printing company right on Canal Street to give me a job. And my career started as a bookkeeper, and I had never seen a calculator before. That is the story of America.
We're going to find that moment a little later in our conversation, but I want to go well before you're 20 years old and a bookkeeper here on Wall Street. You were a bulwark, as I mentioned, of our listed company advisory board. It's fair to say that Wall Street didn't mint a lot of new listed companies in 2023 when I last saw you for an LCAB dinner, Farooq. What market conditions did you see in 1993 as you were going public, and what will it take for private companies to take the plunge that you took way back then as we enter this new year in 2024? You see new Ethan Allens ready to come on the scene?
I think so. But I had taken the company private in a management buyout about 3 years back, and we needed to go to the next stage. We needed to make sure that we have the right kind of financing. I had taken 90% debt to take this company private with interest rates up to 18%. And I must also give a lot of credit to the New York Stock Exchange to welcome us, to take a company at that time. You know, there was a concern whether we were even a going concern. But we were able to convince, and I think that started our journey, and I think that's a tremendously important journey for a lot of entrepreneurs and companies.
What do you get out of the listed company advisory board? It's fair to say, you know, that generally the relationships you make with CEOs of other industries dealing with a variety of management, leadership, and regulatory challenges, you are in some ways the elder statesman of that group, but there's a lot of people to learn from when you get together here.
No, absolutely. You know, the learning is always a process. Every day you learn. You learn. I take a walk in the morning, every morning, and you learn because you're thinking. You are, similarly, when I'm here, I'm listening to lots of entrepreneurs. And it is tremendously important for leaders to listen to others, because you can get caught into your own, you know, environment and don't think. So you always, when I'm here, I'm listening to various people. It is an education.
Before we get into your journey and where the world sits in 2023, let's reflect on some recent developments, including the grand reopening celebrations of your design centers. especially reinventing Ethan Allen as the interior design destination. Now in its 91st year, you personally cut the ribbon on your flagship locations in New York City and Marlton, New Jersey. I see on your website a showcase of your grand reopening events all over the country, Farooq. What's behind what you call this constant reinvention?
Yes, it is. It's a very important part of this constant reinvention. Now, we started as a company, as a manufacturer of products. Then we started selling those products in stores through our own independent dealers. We also introduced the concept of interior design. But it took us about 50 years to come to a position where you can really say that we are an interior design destination. And that was tremendously important. About a year back or so, I thought about it. I said, you know, we talk of interior design, but we are going to make it as a part of our enterprise, as a part of our culture. And to do this, we had to rethink even the size of our stores. We call them interior design centers. And interestingly, that the size of our interior designers centers today is about 50% less than it was 10 years back. We can talk about it later, with a combination of technology and personal service has made it possible. Then we had to take a look at how do we best project our designs. Only 10 years back, folks in New Jersey thought what people wanted there was very different than in Connecticut and California, Florida. It's all a different market. We said no. But we came to the conclusion, but also it's not just us. The design and consumers' interest in the home has come to a degree that they all now can think about good design anywhere. So we said we will develop an interior design destination that is going to be uniformly all across the country. As I said, 10 years back, our interior designers, we are an interior design company. We have the largest interior design network. They would have said it's not possible. But then we brought in, about I think 7 or 8 months back, we did our headquarters design center in Danbury, and we brought in about, I think, 400 or 500 of our interior designers and managers to look at it. They all said, great, fantastic, wow, we like it, because they have to buy it in. We just can't tell them, do it. They bought it in. Then when I saw that they all had bought in, we said, we are now going to do this right across the country. And every week, we are having interior design destination ribbon cuttings. In fact, this evening, I was supposed to be in Whippany, New Jersey, having a ribbon cutting. It is actually one of a design centers still operated by a family that started with us 50 years back, the Esposito family. They delayed it to tomorrow because they were just worried about the weather. I mean, this is an amazing focus. And also, it happened at a time when the economy is sort of weakening. This gave us an opportunity to differentiate. Otherwise, all we could be saying is, you know, come and get it, it's sale and all that kind of stuff. We are now getting a message across. It has also created a tremendous amount of pride among our team. Our interior designers love it. They are interior designers. And so from a perspective of our interior designers, our customers, this really has, it took us 90 years to come to this destination.
And across those 90 years, if you look at the most recent results that you shared, fiscal 2024 first quarter results back in October 25th of last year, you announced consolidated net sales of $164 million, gross margin of 61%. What's the state of the American consumer and their furniture buying habits today, Farooq, with interest rates still high in the real estate market, where ICE is making this bold move into the mortgage industry, sort of in this state of flux about whether, you know, we've topped out on mortgage rates and inventory is so low?
Yeah, you know, this is an important discussion, because when we compare the last 4 years to, let us say, the Great Recession that took place about 10 years back, it is an entirely different experience. At the Great Recession, 10 years back or so, people stopped buying. They were not paying attention to their home. With this focus on the home, with COVID, people staying home, there was a tremendous interest in home. So we had lots of interest, very major increases in sales. But then now we're coming to the next stage. And the next stage is people are now traveling. People are now spending time in other areas. They have already spent a great deal on home. And, you know, we saw in our industry a number of companies continue to think that somehow this is going to keep on going. And they are out of business. Many have declared bankruptcies. We said no. I said about a year back, this thing is going to slow down. So we better prepare ourselves for a slowdown. So today, even though our sales are good and we have prepared ourselves in making sure that we don't do anything crazy stuff, we have controlled our expenses. We have less people today than we had even 5 years back or even 3 years back, but more qualified people. So I'm looking at, as we have said publicly, that obviously times are tougher. But the good news is that we continue to be profitable, generate good cash. And I believe that that's how we are going to continue to operate.
You mentioned the weather delaying your grand reopening in New Jersey by a day. Talking about the weather, one of the notes in that earnings release back in October was lowered shipments of approximately 15 million due to the ravaging effects of flooding in Orleans, Vermont, that took a big toll on one of your manufacturing facilities. I want to just hear a little bit of a local news report from Vermont after the storm.
The video you see here is from Ethan Allen's VP of Domestic Manufacturing, Mike Worth, when the water was at the furniture plant's highest last Tuesday.
We approximately had between 500 and 600 skids here with parts and panels on, and as you can see, they're all being thrown out right now.
He says they tried to prepare better than they did for Irene, but it wasn't enough.
We built berms around the boiler to, in case water comes up, and as well as with our product on the floor, we raised it before the storm came, expecting maybe 10 inches to a foot, but not 4 feet.
I watched the machines work in your plant to remove all that debris, Farooq. That was your colleague, Mike Worth. The reporter mentions Tropical Storm Irene, which deluged my upstate village of Windham back in 2011 and also laid waste to a lot of Vermont. How did you recover from an event like that, and how can you guard against the effects of climate change at your facilities?
Yeah, that's a very important issue. And we do know this, that climate is changing. And we've got to think about it. Now, our plants in Vermont were built. We have two major operations, one in a place called Beecher Falls and the second one in Orleans. They were built right next to rivers because the rivers were the mode of transportation.
Right.
And with this storm that came in, it had a devastating effect because they were thinking that it might probably be a foot of water. It came 4 feet. We had, and today, our plants are full of technology. Technology is what makes it possible for us to continue to manufacture in North America. And so many of those this high-tech equipment was under floods. And we are still recovering. Some of them we have been able to fix, and some we had to buy new ones. Today, the plant is operating at about 75%, 80%. And because we had to buy new equipment, we had to bring in people to repair. And it had an impact. It still has had an impact, but it looks like that another month or 2 months, we'll come back to the normal levels. In terms of preparing, we are looking at to see, like for instance, Orleans plant is a multi-story plant. 10 years back, it was not an issue. Put all the equipment on the first floor. We are now moving it to the second floor. So we're doing those kind of common sense kind of things that you have to do today.
When you got the word that the 4 feet had come up, did you put on the storm boots and go survey the damage and help in the rebuild?
One of the first things I did was that the news that you just referred to, I told them I'm going to talk to you, to them also, because there was a rumor that we might close the plant. So I went on the television. I said, no, we have a long history here. And the next day, the Governor Scott of Vermont said, I'd like to talk to you. And he had a fairly long conversation with me. In fact, he visited the plant the next day. The governor did.
Yeah.
So I think that, I do continue to go there. I like hiking too. I like those mountains. And we're making progress. It takes a long-term commitment to stay in North America,
sure.
State of Vermont. We do have challenges. There are labor issues. There are issues of transportation. But we have a tremendous amount of history. And if we had not invested in the technology that we have, it would be very hard to keep it going.
In 2019, you wrote a memoir, Trailblazer, From the Mountains of Kashmir to the Summit of Global Business and Beyond. It begins in 1949, when you were 4 years old and growing up in Kashmir. Your father heads off to Pakistan on what everyone thought was going to be a brief business trip. It kept him away from home for 17 years. Let's hear a little bit of a Pathé newsreel from before that time.
More news from Kashmir. The once peaceful mountain state, now a battleground of Muslim and Hindu. Since the creation of the two dominions, the leaders of Kashmir's largely Muslim population have revolted against their Hindu ruler. Lines of communications were cut, and the fighting men of Free Kashmir prepared to defend their land as Pandit Nehru poured in troops by air to aid the Hindu minority.
What happened to your dad and your family as a whole as a result?
You see, our family was quite well known. My great-grandfather started a business of arts and crafts, and in fact, also one of his major business was getting sapphires from a mountain area called Kathwari. Our family name is Mattu, but we were also called Kathwaris, so I decided to change it. So they were in the business of arts and crafts. My grandfather also was very much involved with arts and crafts of Kashmir and also getting arts and crafts from connected to the Silk Route, which is, you know, part of that region. My father, on the other hand, had studied law. And when the partition of India and Pakistan took place, Kashmir, of course, they fought over Kashmir. He decided to go to the Pakistan side, because our family were in the side that was controlled by India. He had gone there for a month, but then his permit to come back was cancelled. So he decided to stay there, and not only stay there, but they asked him to be one of the heads of the government. And this was called Azad Kashmir, or Free Kashmir, that's what they called it. Well, after about 2 years or so, or a year or so, with the involvement of Madeleine Albright's father,
Corbell,
and Admiral Nimitz, who were given the responsibility of conducting a plebiscite in Kashmir by the United Nations. He met them because he was a minister of law and all of that. So he somehow arranged through them to have my mother and us come back. But I had an older brother and sister. They were in school and we weren't. So our grandfather said, you know, this whole thing is going to be for a few months. You go over across. And we did. So we went, but then, you know, instead of 4 or 5 months, it ended up 10 years. And we ended up staying at about 8,000 feet. That's where we grew up. And we saw conflict. We saw a problem. But after 10 years, we were allowed to come back, but not our father.
You were a strong cricketer, as you write, but not such a great student at SP College. What made you live in a cowshed for a couple of years? And how did it all end up for you? As you said on the cricket pitch, if you're not playing, you're practicing.
I grew up in the mountains. My father was very deeply involved with politics. So I was sort of more or less on my own. So I was pretty independent. But when I came back to Kashmir, to our main house, my grandfather was very, very well known. He had all kinds of properties, everything else. But I was pretty independent. And I had some arguments with him. And one of the arguments was a silly thing like cricket boots. I needed to get a new shoes. He said, write an application. I said, application? I said, as of now, I'm not going to get anything from you. I have to do anything with you. I'm not even going to live in your house. Then the question was, I was about, I think, 16, 17 or so. So where do I go? And he had in the back of his property was a small mud hut, cow shed. The cow was in the bottom, so two little rooms at the top with no glass, no windows, no electricity and all that stuff. I said, I'm going to live there. That became my first construction project. I fixed the windows, I plastered the walls and did something extremely dangerous. Right across the wall, outside wall, was an electric pole. I climbed the pole and connected electricity, which was not, of course, legal also, right to my cottage. I could not be here. It was so stupid. But anyway, I lived there for 3 years, was pretty independent. And I, of course, spent a lot of my time playing cricket. Now, my grandfather and others at that time, they wanted most families wanted you to either study medicine or engineering. But I was in sports, so I didn't tell him. I went, that was one of my other arguments with him. I ended up, but I became quite good at sports. And in fact, the college where I went to, the head of the college gave me an office, which is in my book, that at a fairly young age, I spent all my time studying, playing cricket, but I also had interest. And in fact, some of those professors would come into my office to teach me English literature and political science. And then my father, who was still on the Pakistan side, after he had gone from politics, the New York World's Fair took place. So he got an opportunity. He said, he got a job at the New York's World's Fair. So he thought by coming to America, maybe he will have an opportunity to go back home. So when he was here, and I was in my final year of college in Kashmir, he said, why don't you apply for colleges? Of course, I had no idea. So he did. He applied to New York University, to Columbia, to other places, but then said, you got to go to school where you can go at night because you'll have to work during the day. And NYU had that opportunity. So I ended up applying and coming to America.
So that year that you talk about, maybe a year before I'm born, when you visit Flushing Meadows in Queens today, you might watch a Mets game or a few matches at the U.S. Open at the Billie Jean King National Tennis Center. But in 1964, the scene was totally different. I want to hear just a little bit from another one of those Pathé newsreels.
The Mormon Church lifted straight from Salt Lake City and one of the Chrysler creations. 8,000 workmen bulldozed 1 million cubic yards of earth to bring 4 years of planning to an extravagant 2-year life. Now get a glimpse of London without ever leaving this square mile of super showmanship where the theme is man's breathtaking achievement in an expanding universe. And you don't need to go to Hollywood to see Grauman's Chinese Theater and its famous film star handprints.
Now, Farooq, World's Fairs are sort of... kids today can't imagine what they were intended to do in 1964, what your dad was hired to do with, you know, the pavilion that he was working on, or what it would, might mean for a young man like you to be out in Flushing, working these grounds and then going to NYU at night. But paint a picture for a listener of what a young man from Kashmir, how they get indoctrinated and transformed and almost transported to all these different parts of the world in Queens for a couple of years.
No, it was really an amazing. It was amazing. The first is when I came from Kashmir to New York, India and Pakistan were fighting over it. There's war going on. So we were not allowed to put any lights unless you got very sick or something. So when I was landing, I saw lights all over. The only time you were allowed to have lights is if it was a marriage. I said, people must be getting married here all over the place. But then I went to the first thing, of course, the next day I went to the fair. And it was just what an amazing experience. You had these pavilions. You had pavilions for, like, the General Motors had a pavilion. The Chrysler had a pavilion. You had technology companies. You had Disney. And all of them had pavilions, that it was almost like going through the tour of major exhibitions of the world were all in the Flushing Meadows and in the World's Fair.
So my brother's name is Richard King, but it's not the same Richard King that gave you a job at Imperial Envelope for $1.75 an hour. As their bookkeeper, you mentioned that first job earlier, you learned that, I'm going to quote you, if you have the intelligence and instincts to solve problems in one setting, you can probably solve them in another setting. Here at ICE, we are all about problem solving. What's your approach to problem solving?
You see, for instance, yeah, you mentioned about that first job. When I saw this ad, I did get admission at NYU Bridges School, which was about a block from here, right on Church Street. And that too was by itself an amazing thing that they gave me. That I had appeared in a test. I had to go to Bombay in India to appear in a graduate admissions business. I must have done all right because I got admission. So I needed a job. So I saw this ad. It said bookkeeper needed. I asked my class fellows, what's a bookkeeper? They said, don't apply. As I had said earlier, I had never seen a calculator. But I said, what's the worst that would do? They'll say no. So I went there. Fortunately, it was around lunchtime. That helped. So when I went there, there were these two partners, Richard King and Jesse Isaacson. company was called Imperial Envelope Company, 446 Broadway. I've forgotten a million addresses.
But not 446
not
Broadway.
Not 446 Broadway. So they had two rooms. One room is where the Richard King, Jesse Isaacson, and there was a, those days called a Gal Friday. Her name was Sally. And Abe printed the envelopes in the other back room. So I went there. He said, "You're looking for a bookkeeper job?" I said, "Yes, sir, I am." So he said, "Okay, let me see what we can do." He took me a desk. He opened up a ledger, and there was a calculator. I'd never seen a calculator. He said, "Would you foot it?" I said, "Does he want me to kick it?" So I said, "What's it in English?" He said, "What do you mean in English? Where have you learned bookkeeping?" So I had to think fast. I said, "England." The only thing in England I had done was change a plane. So anyway, fortunately, as I said, so I said, "Okay, let me look at it." That the Sally was looking at me, and fortunately, it was lunchtime, and they had to go somewhere. And so they said, "Would you come back?" I said, "No, I'll wait." So this lady just came and said, "You know, I've been looking at you. Know anything about bookkeeping?" I said, "No, but tell me, how does it work? What is this calculator? What is this book?" And you know, in 45 minutes, she gave me an education about bookkeeping. So when these folks came in, so she had done most of the work. She had done all the ads and all of that. When they came, "Yeah, that's pretty good." So what do you think about our bookkeeping? I said, "It needs a lot of work." Well, I got the job, and the adventure started. It's amazing that, you know, that first job led me to Wall Street.
You know, there aren't any horn and hard art automats left in New York City, but you still ride the subway when you spend time in New York City. It's always easy to say, "How are you and where are you from?" which is your sort of stock and trade door opener. But how did that outgoing personality open doors for you in America, and where did it lead?
Well, think of it that here, the first, when I was there at this Imperial Envelope Company, my grandfather in Kashmir decided to help me. My father had helped, asked him. So he said, "I'm sending you 12 wicker baskets of arts and crafts. Sell them. Send us the cost, and going to start." My first thing was, by this time I was living in Brooklyn. What would I do? Where would I keep? Anyway, I found the solution. And then our class at NYU had received a lecture from the CEO of Bloomingdale's. His name was Marvin Traub, very well known. So I called his office. I said, "I have something very important to discuss, Mr. Traub." He said, "What is it?" I said, "No, I have to meet him personally. They're busy." I called 12, 13 days every day. Finally, they said, "Okay, he's going to see you." So I went to Bloomingdale's on, you know, 59th Street with some of those products. He brought in a merchant and they liked it. So Bloomingdale's became my first customer. And that's how I started in my business environment.
How then did an oversized photo of the Grand Canyon ultimately lead you to Nat Ansel and that conversation about Ethan Allen?
Yes. In fact, but then I realized right next to Bloomingdale's was what is called the D&D building, the design building, then was Lord & Taylor. So I went to all of these folks. I met designers. At that time in Kashmir, they made a lot of embroidery, but they made it in rugs. So I saw this Grand Canyon photograph. I sent it to Kashmir and said, "Why don't you embroider this?" They did. And all of a sudden, it was interesting. The folks on the D&D building loved it. And my business started in developing other products. But then about 7 months later or 8 months later, when I was working with the Imperial Company in Bookkeeper, they said to me, "You know, your school is near Wall Street. Why don't you go get a job on Wall Street?" I said, "What does Wall Street do? What job should I ask for?" They said, "Go tell them you're a financial analyst." And so I went to the first building on Wall Street, right close to here. It used to be called the Irving Trust Building. Walked up, and the 16th floor was Bear Stearns. And I still remember that the director of personnel who talked to me, I filled in an application. They said some extracurricular activities. I said, "Mountain climbing." Well, you know, I lived in the mountains. He said, "I love mountains. Tell me more about it." So he was more interested in mountains. You know, sometimes you connect. He said, "I've got to get you a job here." So I got a job as a junior financial analyst with Bear Stearns right next door. So it was then, only about a year later, the Rothschilds of Europe had established a company here right on 70 Pine Street.
New Court Securities.
And they had established a fund called the Five Arrows Fund, which represented the five Rothschild families. And somehow they wanted somebody to help as a junior analyst to the portfolio manager. My name came up, so I went there. Long story, but again, the fellow who was met me first, Larry Harris was his name, he helped me get the job. And I ended up working for the Rothschilds. And it was there, one of my associates, his name was Roger Widman, is in the book. He said, you know, you're selling all these accessories and artifacts. I know the founder of Ethan Allen. Why don't you come and meet him? I said, yes. Ethan Allen used to be at that time right on Lexington Avenue and 33rd Street. So I went to see Nat and Sal. The first time I met him, he brought in a merchant. They said, this young man is from Kashmir. Do we get anything from there? They said, yes, we get this fabric. Never comes on time. Always a problem. He looks at me and says, you can help? I said, absolutely. Of course, I had no idea. But I got in the fabric business. That's how I started with Ethan Allen.
Before we get into the break and then get into building today's Ethan Allen interiors and the industry today, what was Nat and Ted's business at the time? 250 independent stores operating under the Ethan Allen Gallery umbrella. How did that work?
Well, you see, when they started, they were both, especially Nat and Sal, was an entrepreneur. He was a visionary. At that time, most furniture was sold. I'm talking the 1930s, 40s, was sold like a commodity. And so he said, no, people should at least see how does a bedroom look like, dining room look like. So he convinced stores like Macy's, Marshall Fields and others to establish what they call Ethan Allen Galleries. So the gallery program was very simple, very basic, but at least people could see a dining room. Then the second stage was that they realized that the department stores are not going to be able to give a lot of service, that these stores, these Ethan Allen galleries should be put into furniture stores operated by people who are focused on furniture. So they converted a lot of Ethan Allen, a lot of dealers who were selling furniture, and they converted into an Ethan Allen gallery. They're different names. Their names were Georgetown Manor, Carriage House, Bob's Ethan Allen, Bob's Georgetown. But that's all right. So that's how they started, by converting in the 1960s, 1970s, Ethan Allen galleries were opening up, operated by independent families. Ethan Allen was not in the retail itself. It had 30 manufacturing plants. It started in Vermont, ended up manufacturing from mid-Atlantic to the West Coast, to the South Carolinas, even Oklahoma. But these dealers operated Ethan Allen galleries all around the country.
And how did your business, KEA, fit into that model?
When I first started, I called my business Kashmir Products Limited, P.O. Box Wall Street Station, because I had no address. And that was selling the fabrics. And then after a year or so, Nat and Sal calls me again. He says, you know, we're having trouble getting rugs from India and Romania. Can you help? I said, absolutely. Of course, I had no idea where Romania was. I had no idea where rugs in India were made. But I went, I found the solution, went to India, and found the place and started the rug business with Ethan Allen. So he knew me. He sort of saw me and he said, you know, I really would like you to come to Ethan Allen to work. By this time, I had become the chief financial officer of the Rothschild Company. Well, my bookkeeping experience was crazy now, you know, 3 or 4 years later. I said to him, you know, I've got a pretty good job. I'm now the chief financial officer, and the Rothschilds wanted me to stay. John Berkland, he actually was also on the board of the New York Stock Exchange many, many years back. He was the CEO, but he wanted me to stay. So finally, I went to Nat and Sal, said, you know, I'll consider doing it, but it's got to be a partnership. So we agreed to form a company called KEA, Kathwari Ethan Allen. I own 60%, Ethan Allen 40%. I gave up my job and started developing products from Ethan Allen. Those days, Italy was the main source of products. So I set up an office in Florence, in Italy. I had two very, very talented people and started developing a lot of products from Florence, from Italy. They went to Spain, went to many, many. So the KEA, I was one of the first ones to go to China to develop products. This was a time when Mao Zedong and Chou Enlai, they were all, it was a different China. But we developed all of those. And then in 1980, he really said, you got to come here and work. So I said, what would I do? Why would I come to Ethan Allen? Had moved to Danbury, Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, why, what would make you do? I said, the only reason is to come to take your job. He said, you were shocked, surprised. But that's how I went to Ethan Allen.
And we will get into the rest of that story after the break. We're going to continue our journey with Farooq Kathwari from Ethan Allen headquarters in Danbury to span the globe again and again as the company evolves to what it's become today under Farooq's leadership. That's all coming up right after this.
Their grandfather once crashed an auto show by driving through a plate glass window on purpose. Their father was the most awarded SUV ever. And their crazy uncle raced sports cars and won. And while the blood of their relatives still runs true, none of them can do what these can. Introducing the next generation of Jeep Grand Cherokee. Available in 2-row, 3-row, and 4xe. The legacy lives on.
Welcome back. Before the break, Farooq Kathwari, the chairman, president, and CEO of Ethan Allen, that's NYSE ticker symbol ETD, and I were discussing his journey from the mountains of Kashmir to the canyons of Wall Street and ultimately to the rolling hills of Danbury, Connecticut during his formative years as an entrepreneur, a merchant, and now a burgeoning leader of Ethan Allen. The company at this point had been sold to this St. Louis-based conglomerate Interco, which owned the Florsheim, Converse, London Fog brands. Meanwhile, Nat is getting into furniture manufacturers and even hotels with a sort of Walt Disney-like aspirations up in Danbury. And you're tooling around near Olana in upstate New York in a restored World War II Jeep. How did you and Nat arrive at an understanding of where the company would go from there? Before the break, you said basically the only opportunity would be to take your job.
That's right, yeah. So you see, a number of things happened in 1980 when I joined the company. And he said, I said to him, he said, you know, I can't promise to you, but that's not always an opportunity. I said, but keep in mind that if I come here, that's what I'm going to do. He smiled and we went on. Then right after that, a number of factors happened, family things happened with Nat and Sal. Ted had retired and they decided, the family, to sell the company. And at that time, it was the age of the conglomerates. This company, Interco, in St. Louis, had decided that, and other companies were thinking of it too, that the furniture industry should be consolidated. It's operating too many independent operators. So they then purchased Ethan Allen, they purchased Broyhill, and they purchased Lane, and became the largest in the furniture business. Another company called Masco. Masco also decided that, yes, they should be a conglomerate, and they purchased companies like Thomasville, Hendredon, Lane. So all of a sudden, these two companies purchased some of the leading furniture companies. Now, Interco, when they had purchased it, and I had, by this time, I had gone, 1985, became president, so I was, of course, dealing with them. And they came under a hostile takeover bid. By those folks who still exist, Apollo operators are still here. And Interco then hired advisors who, at that time, one of the ways they did was they advised that take a lot of debt and perhaps these folks will go away. So they took a tremendous amount of debt and really put their company into an issue. So at this time, I thought about the fact that perhaps we have an opportunity to take the company private. Now, with my connections on Wall Street, that also helped. So I was able to work with John Berkland, who was my former CEO, former boss, was by this time running a company called Dillon Reed, Smith Barney. Also, I had known Sandy Weil. So I got, then I also knew, I'd called Jack Welch in Connecticut, and these are all, you know, very...
These are the great names.
The great names. So Gary Wendt was running GE Capital. So Gary Wendt. So anyway, long story short, I convinced them to partner with me. So they all partnered and we established a Green Mountain Holding Corporation based in my... I had also gone into real estate. I had purchased a bowling lanes. That was my first office for my joint venture. Then I bought two other buildings. So we bought, long story, it was not easy, but we were able to buy Ethan Allen in a leverage buyout with interest rates that ultimately went up to 18%. It was crazy. With 90% debt. And then that's when we went public on the New York Stock Exchange. All these folks helped because my involvement with Sandy Weill, actually Jamie Dimon was a person, he worked for Sandy Weill.
And Jimmy Lee plays a big part in your story.
Jimmy
Lee,
yeah, he was at Chemical Bank. So they all really, it's amazing these guys, how these connections and all of them helped. Walter Shipley was the head of Chemical Bank, and Jimmy Lee worked for him. And we made the deal that they would finance me at some resort place in West Virginia where Walter Shipley took me in his plane.
Is that the Greenbrier? Or?
I think the Greenbrier, yeah. Yes. In fact, Walter Shipley, again, you know, these coincidences. When he was a student, when he had gone out of Columbia, he got to work at the United Nations, and his assignment was Kashmir. Hmm. You know, these sort of amazing coincidences. He came from the family of Brown brother Harriman, called Shipley.
Right.
So he made the deal here. You know, it related connections because he was working on the Kashmir issue when he was graduated from, I think, Columbia. So he, of course, I was still involved very much in the Kashmir issue. But he said, okay, we'll make things happen. And we did. And so with GE, with Smith Barney, with Chemical Bank also. And at that time, they could also not only give you loans, they can also be a stockholder. I don't think they can do it now, but they did. So they all became stockholders and gave loans.
So you've got the banks and the financiers all lined up, but within the confines of Ethan Allen, you got 250 independent stores, 30 manufacturing plants across the country. You are, as to quote yourself from your book, a man with an unusual name from a faraway part of the world. Obviously, you know, you got the Wall Street patricians to come to your aid, but you're now leading an iconic American brand. How did you go about winning over all of your internal constituents? Part of the answer found, I think, at the great American national parks like Yellowstone and Pikes Peak, huh?
Well, there are a number of factors. First was, of course, when I became president, we had major manufacturing. We were a manufacturing company. So I had, of course, visited there, but we had a president who came from the New England. So he said, let's go to Vermont and you should talk to our 2,000 employees. We had 2,000 people working there. So I went there. So they looked at me, this name Farooq, they never heard of it. So I looked at them. I said, you know, I've of course come to Vermont before. Vermont I like, because it reminds me of Kashmir Mountains. And we have something in common, which is what you say in Kashmir. So that most of the problems of the world have been created by flatlanders. Do you folks agree? They say, yes. You have to. Then I had to go. Of course, I had previously, when I was selling my fabrics, I had gone to North Carolina. We had the upholstery fabrics. So those folks, you know, had come to know me. Now, the Ethan Allen dealers were very important. They owned, they operated the retail. And they had associations, the West Coast Association, the Southwest, the Midwest, and Mid-Atlantic. My first was in the West Coast, very strong dealers, every one of them. So they invited me. Nat and Sal used to go there before that at Bombridge. So they looked at me, and so they said, tell us what you're going to do for us. So I told them what I thought should be done, but they said, now let me tell you what I want you to do for me. If not, you're going to hear from me.
Right.
They laughed. But you had to. The other thing was this, which you had earlier mentioned. The meeting was being held in a hotel near an airport in San Francisco. They said, we have these meetings. Why don't you come and join us? I have a condition. I said, what? I said, West has such beautiful places. Why are we having a meeting at the airport? Let's go and meet at the Grand Canyon. Let's meet in Jackson Hole. All those. First they laughed, then they agreed. So for the next 10, 12 years, we had meetings in one of the most beautiful places, not only in the West Coast, but then I convinced our dealer associations in the Southwest to have meetings. They used to have an airport hotel in Dallas. I said, let's have a meet in Santa Fe. Let's meet in everywhere else. We came to know each other. Similarly, Midwest, they were the most conservative. They used to always meet at Chicago Airport. I said, you got Great Lakes here. Let's go there. And then the Mid-Atlantic, we started meeting in Florida and Carolinas and the Bahamas. Well, what it did was this, it created a bond. It also was an education for me because these were very experienced retailers. Some of them, in fact, we were few still around that have been with us for 80, 90 years. Even today, I'm meeting one tomorrow and in Whippany, New Jersey, he's opening, he's doing the ribbon cutting. Phil Esposito, I think is now his children are also running it, but he's still there. They're with us, I think, 50, 60 years. So these folks are tremendous. In any case, developed an association. It helped us. But then they started retiring. The question was, should we now sell our products outside? We at Ethan Allen, we also owned two or three other companies that sold products to others. I felt I was always the captain of a cricket team. So I said, well, I want to have one team. How can I tell you folks to be completely work with us if we are not? So I sold all those companies. It was not an easy thing to do. Then I told the retailers, you're going to change your name. Every store had a different name.
No more Carriage House Ethan Allen.
Exactly. Carriage House, Whippany Manor, Georgetown Manor. It was not easy. I had a revolt. It's in my book by a number of them that got together. But anyway, they convinced, they helped, and then they started retiring. As they retired, I created a formula. I said, don't get big, huge financial advisors. This is what I'm going to do. And I'll be fair. I'm not going to give one different than others. It took a little time. They all agreed. And then in the next, I think, 5-10 years, we purchased 80% of them, one at a time. But the other challenge was that most of these stores had been opened in the 1950s, 1960s. By now, they were not in the right locations. So our next was to relocate them. So we have now, in the last 15, 20 years, relocated 80% of them. And it still continues.
So you've relocated them. And, you know, at the same time that demographics are changing, geography is changing, America's tastes are beginning to evolve. It's not the old-time colonial look anymore that I described in the intro. How did Ethan Allen change with the times from the furniture that you were making to the look and feel of your stores, even the logo? An Apple store is always going to look like an Apple store, Farooq, but an Ethan Allen store isn't always an Ethan Allen store. Eventually, you had to sort of think about the next chapter of the American consumer.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, one of the major revolutions took place right here in Manhattan. We used to have an Ethan Allen in there, 32nd Street. And I decided that Manhattan was an important one. So we took a fairly large, right on 65th Street and 3rd Avenue. And we said, this is going to be the model of Ethan Allen. So we then had our new logo, new name at that time, and products had been developed. So we then invited all our, these are all dealers and their families. And we had a big, huge event at the Waldorf. We even invited folks from the Broadway to show the new Ethan Allen. We had to make it into an event that this is the new Ethan Allen. We also changed in Danbury, Connecticut, where our headquarters is. We had the same colonial look. It was a colonial look with, you know, with the green and blue and all of that. So we changed that. I had hired an architect to change the looks. And then now we had to convince our dealers, because at that time they were all dealers. So we convinced them. We had many meetings. We had we convinced a folk. And we had a dealer in Chicago to convert. We had a dealer in San Diego to convert, in Florida. So the process started of converting Ethan Allen from the colonial to where we are today. We had to change. They were all different names. So we had to change the names. We had to call Ethan Allen. We had to change the design. We had to change the color of our. So the process started and the process still continues because today our focus is that I use the terminology that we are classics with a modern perspective.
I should ask you about doing business in Connecticut. I worked for the Hartford for many years and the antiquated state political apparatus is very difficult to deal with. We also saw General Electric mention Jack Welch and his successors head to Boston. United Technologies get absorbed by Raytheon. We've had Governor Ned Lamont here on the show. How have you managed to stay happy in Danbury for so many years?
The number of factors. First is that we have a lot of good people working for us, and they come from that area. That's the most important one. If that was not the case, then perhaps, you know, we would have said, should we be here? They're hardworking people, very dedicated. We have hardly any turnover at Ethan Allen, hardly any turnover. But we have less people today than obviously, you know, 30 years back, we had 500 people working in our headquarters. Mm. Today, they have 200. A lot of it due to technology. We have maintained very good relationships with the people in Danbury, in Hartford, of course, with the governor. But, you know, having said all of those things, we focus on what we can do and don't spend too much of time depending on them. We've been also very deeply involved with the Westcon, which is a Western Connecticut State University, which is right next to us. In fact, one of the first things we did was when Ansel was retiring and they were putting up a complex next to us, we then invested. It's called the Ansel School of Business. Then later on, our own family foundation established a Kathwari Honors Program. So you have to be part of the community. So we have 500 students now. Wow. Under the Kathwari Honors Program. So, you know, we have not asked the state to do too much for us. We said we're going to run our business. We're going to do what's the right thing to do with our people, with the community. And you know, that we would do that anywhere we were.
What's the best place to manufacture furniture today? As we said earlier, you inherited 30 plants. Sometimes there's a flood like the one in Orleans, Vermont. Takes out one of them for a little while. We don't love seeing made in China on our sofas, and it's hard to get them through the port of Los Angeles in a container. What's the best mix of domestic and international manufacture today, and what benefits does Mexico offer?
Yes, you know, it's a very important issue because, as I said, 30 years back, we had 30 manufacturing plants from New Hampshire, Vermont to California. 15, 20 years back, manufacturing was leaving the United States, was going to East Asia. In all areas, but in our industry too. So we had to decide, should we follow? And it was a tough decision because those folks were doing a pretty good job. We said, no, we want to control our own destiny. Then I looked around and I said, let's look south of the border. And the first place, must have been 15, 18 years back, went to southern Mexico in a state called Guanajuato. And it was actually a small plant run by a former U.S. colonel in the Air Force, and his family. So I went there, I saw, you know, I also make decisions. At the end of the day, we decided to buy it. Because I said, south of the border, you know, we are all worried about only these folks coming across the border and all those problems. Help those people. The tremendous opportunity. It's, most folks go to offshore because it's easy. They don't have to make an investment. Here we had to make an investment. Then we said, what do we have to do to grow? Well, in the next few years, we took this 50,000 square foot plant to 600,000 square feet, from 150 people to 1,000 people, and invested a lot in technology. Because I've traveled a lot to China, mm-hmm. to Vietnam. Those folks have a lot of technology. If we don't, America, invest in technology, we're not going to have any manufacturing. Those folks have low labor cost and high technology. I said, we're going to look at Mexico. Then we established an upholstery plant because one of the major challenges in North Carolina where we have upholstery is we can't find workers to cut and sew. Our medical costs in the United States is crazy. I mean, all those factors we have to keep in mind. But all the fabric that we have now is cut in Mexico and shipped every day to North Carolina. Keeping them busy. But only 20 years back, all this fabric was cut by hand, by scissors. Today, it's all cut by high-tech computer-operated technology. Similarly, I was looking at wood products. We were in Vermont and a lot of other places. I said, let's look at south of the border. It just so happened that one of the ambassadors of American ambassador to Honduras was a good friend of mine. He said, come to Honduras. I said, all we hear about Honduras is problems. He said, no, come. So I went to Honduras. He introduced me to the heads of the government and others. And, you know, unfortunately, we think that there are problems that you have to look at the better side. So, but anyway, after 2 days, I found a place. I found a big plant that had been built as a furniture, but all manufacturing had gone to East Asia. So we bought that plant, and today, and interestingly, you got to also make it. I was meeting the foreign minister, who was a trade minister. Sitting at the table was this lady, very smart. Carolina is her name, Carolina Pasqua. So I said to him jokingly, I said, if we come here, she's to work for us. Well, for the 12 years, Carolina is running our Honduras operation. And we have about 800 people over there, investor, great in technology. We had to invest in the high tech, all safeguards for the people, and you know, from environmental to. So to answer your question, I think for us, the combination of in North America and across the border makes sense. Like, for instance, our operations in Honduras, all the wood is supplied from our wood operations we have in North Carolina. All we have kiln drying, we get all the lumber there. For instance, in Vermont, we have sawmills. We ship them all the lumber because we want the products to be the same as here. Today, from a consumer's point of view, you would not know the difference if the product is made in Vermont, North Carolina, Mexico, or Honduras.
I mean, you smell inside that drawer, it still smells like that Carolina or Vermont pine. It just happened to have made a pit stop in Honduras on the way back.
Yeah, because we send them the wood from here. That's what it is. Now, we also have a plant, we don't own it, in Indonesia for those kinds of products we cannot make in North America.
So I was in the process of ordering a couple new closets from California Closets a couple weeks ago. The ability to meet with the designer over Zoom, have them take measurements remotely, show me design alternatives real time. It's all amazing with all of their costs calculated right on the screen. You said in your last earnings call that, I'm going to quote you here, today we have about 30% less interior design professionals who are doing about the same business. In fact, from 2019, our total headcount in the company is less by 21%. How is technology changing Ethan Allen's business?
Technology is changing in all elements. We have spent a fair amount of time talking about our manufacturing. But on the retail side, today, technology is enabling our interior designers to work with clients. I have actually every weekend, I get about 50 reports from our team. And they also send me what is called a wow event. How a designer has, they send me stories. Then I write to every designer. So it's a busy weekend I have, but what you see in is, and many of those stories is how our designer has worked with a client in the design center or from wherever they are with our technology and creating a virtual technology in having the customers take a look at their whole room, what it's going to look like, what products could be there, change them. If that was not the case, we would not be reducing our space. So the combining very professional interior designers with technology is key. And that's what's made it happen to us.
The notion of the massive Arizona subdivision filled with McMansions was giving way perhaps to people wanting smaller living space in cities with denser populations, like where I live in the West Village. They also want maybe more sustainable materials used in the products that they buy. What's Ethan Allen's answer to those trends?
No, absolutely. In fact, environmental focus has been always very important for us. We have received many, many awards. For instance, Mexico, we have, for the last few years, have received an award from the government as the best place to work in Mexico. Environmental is tremendously important. Same thing in Honduras. Certainly, we have been doing it for a long time in the United States. But we went over there, and they said to me, it's not required. I said, no, you're going to follow exactly, as far as I'm concerned, think you're in Vermont. So I think from that perspective, environmental sustainability, once you make it a part of your culture, now, in our case, you know, we are unique. It also limits us because we limits us in the sense that we don't sell our products to others. All our products are sold through the Ethan Allen design centers. Now, we could grow our business if we were to sell to others, but then it will not be a cricket team. So that's another factor.
So when I talked to you a couple of weeks ago, talking about the cricket team, you noted that Ethan Allen is going to celebrate its 92nd anniversary in 2024. It's such a momentous year in so many ways, Farooq. A presidential election may spell the difference in trade and economic policies that could benefit or hurt Ethan Allen. What's at stake in November for the company, do you think?
I think what's at stake is for the country. I think that's more important. I think we have to see, how do we keep America vibrant? How do we keep America as a leader in all aspects? And we also want to have leadership that thinks somewhat long-term. Unfortunately, short-term is a disease. So I think that from the country's point of view, I wish that there will be more long-term thinking. There'll be more areas of taking care of people. For instance, one of the biggest challenges we have is medical costs in America. I mentioned that. In fact, I was right. I think it was here when the Secretary of Commerce was here. So I mentioned the medical costs. Our medical costs are 2 or 3 times higher than Canada, 15 times higher than Mexico, and 25 times higher than Honduras. We've got to, that to me is one of the major factors that we have to take a look at, because we're losing jobs. Why would people, if they can have manufacturing or service or technology in other countries, because the cost in the United States of medical is so high.
There's a lot at stake, not only for the country, but for the world as well. Farooq, you've known personal tragedy that's caused you to become much more involved politically, both here in the U.S. and overseas where you grew up. As we look at Israel and Gaza, at Russia and Ukraine, and the many trouble spots in between, do you enter this year with despair or a degree of hope?
Well, of course, the recent events in all those areas you have mentioned is despair, is sadness, because you want people to live together, to live well. And short-term thinking is not good. And so, unfortunately, there is a despair, but sometimes tragedy helps you with an opportunity, because we want peace. And I think that that's what we're hoping for and praying for.
If you weren't running Ethan Allen, besides returning to the cricket pitch, how would Farooq Kathwari be spending most of his time?
Well, you know, whatever I do it with passion. I haven't spent a week at our farm in Hudson, New York, but I spent a week. But I always think of projects. And so this project is to take, we have a pond and a lake, of completely reinventing it. So I'm creating walkways. I'm already doing it. And next year, we're going to have a major wildflowers put into the farm. So I'm always thinking of things. It doesn't matter whether I am at Ethan Allen or at the farm. Always think of creative ways of moving forward.
A story of constant reinvention from Kashmir to commerce.
That's right, yes.
We appreciate so much your time coming to the New York Stock Exchange and joining us for a little while inside the ISS, Farooq.
It's always a pleasure, and I've got a great, great association, and spend a fair amount of my time right here in this area.
And I hope you continue to do so. You're always welcome back. Look forward to your next visit as well. That's our conversation for this week. Our guest was Farooq Kathwari, Chairman, President, and CEO of Ethan Allen. That's NYSE ticker symbol ETD. If you like what you heard, please rate us on Apple Podcasts so other folks know where to find us. If you've got a comment or a question you'd like one of our experts to tackle on a future show, make sure to leave a review, email us at icehouse@ice.com, or tweet at us at icehousepodcast. Our show is produced by Lance Glynn, with production assistance and engineering editing from Ken Abel. I'm Josh King, your host, signing off from the library of the New York Stock Exchange. Thanks for listening. We'll talk to you next week.
Information contained in this podcast was obtained in part from publicly available sources and not independently verified. Neither ICE nor its affiliates make any representations or warranties, express or implied, as to the accuracy or completeness of the information, and do not sponsor, approve, or endorse any of the content herein, all of which is presented solely for informational and educational purposes. Nothing herein constitutes an offer to sell, a solicitation of an offer to buy any security, or a recommendation of any security or trading practice. Some portions of the preceding conversation may have been edited for the purpose of length or clarity.